I suppose I am one of the last of that pastoral school, the school of etchers who use the countryside of England as their source. Now my work is rather fashionable. People like it. Perhaps one day, soon, they won't like it at all. I just don't know. But I can only etch in the way I etch. I'm not consciously a pastoral etcher at all. I etch the things I love, and they come out in that sort of way. I couldn't do it differently.
Robin and Heather Tanner have lived in one corner of northwest Wiltshire all their lives, and their great passion has been to document its timeless qualities, she in words, he in drawings and etchings. In their lifetime, the Tanners have seen even remote and lovely landscapes like this, threatened by progress. They believe that it needn't be so, that their vision of Wiltshire can be preserved.
In these foothills of the Cotswolds, these little greystone villages with their tiny meadows and hedgerows and woods, I find everything I want to draw, you see. I go dotty about them, just as I suppose a Yorkshireman does about his dales, but I find this is my place. This is where I really belong. For me, in this corner of northwest Wiltshire, which I know best of all, there's so much crying out to be etched. Everything I want to say is in the world of black and white. That range of tones you get on a copper plate from fine silvery lines and pale greys to dark luminous blacks, everything is there. I can never embark on a new etching until, in my mind's eye, I've seen the whole thing most beautifully finished. When I start to compose an etching, I like to surround myself with all my studies. Some of these are the wild daffodil I see go back to March 1941. I don't actually copy any of my earlier drawings, but I like to get the essence, so to speak, of the daffodil, so that I really make up new daffodils from the drawings which I have round me. And then I work away in Indian ink on a piece of white board, and it's really a rather lovely occupation.
Robin uses ink rather than pencil for the composition because it approximates more closely to what the finished etching will look like. When his design is ready, he puts it in front of a sloping mirror. This gives a reverse image which he can copy onto a copper plate, scratching with a needle through a top coating of pitch and wax.
It's a lovely sensation, a beautiful, sensuous feeling of this fine needle going through this sympathetic ground. And every line you put down, of course, is flattered by the glinting of the copper. Of course, what one has to remember is that all the pieces of copper left that are black here will obviously be white when it's printed. And all these shining copper lines are going to be gorged with ink. And they, of course, will be jet black. It's easily the nicest part of etching, I think. You go into a marvellous world. You forget lunchtime, tea time, and all times. You just are carried away by it. I'm supposed to needle this plate. March is about 3 weeks' work. Then, of course, I don't devote the whole of my days to etching. There are all the ordinary chores to do, and a vast correspondence, and a large garden, and many causes, mostly minority ones, that I care deeply about, so that etching just has to take its place among many other activities. But I never cease to wonder at it. It's a marvellous craft, and I shall go on till I drop.
Robin keeps a detailed record of the next decisive stages, which have remained unchanged since the days of Rembrandt. First, the plate has been soaked in a mild acid bath, called the Dutch bath, which has eaten its way into the fine tracery of exposed copper.
It's a very slow-acting bath, and it bites lines which are deep and fine and silvery. You then turn to a quite different acid, nitric. Now, nitric is as fierce as the Dutch bath is gentle. It bubbles away and eats into the lines, and you have to use a feather to sweep the bubbles away, otherwise your copper would be absolutely eaten up under your eyes. But it gives you rugged, dark, rich, velvety blacks, so it's marvellous for all the darker portions.
Plate can go through the baths time and time again. When the acid has bitten deeply enough into any one section, that part is covered with varnish to protect it from further scoring. Progressively, more and more is varnished over, until the voracious acid can bite no further and the plate is ready for printing. With the varnish removed, Robin then applies black ink with a pinch of red to get the luster he wants.
Well, this has to be a good print, Heather, because this is final. I refuse to do any more on it. It's a lovely ink I have. I made it very carefully.
This is the point where four hands are needed in the etching process. Not because Robin couldn't physically do it all himself, but because his hands soon get so smeared with viscous black that they're in no state to touch the precious paper.
Actually, I couldn't do it without Heather. She couldn't do it without me. I must be very, very soiled with ink. She can keep perfectly clean, and you need two human beings, a clean one and a dirty one, to produce a good etching.
Having used his fingers to smooth the ink into every last crevice and to feel for the fatal pieces of grit which could scar the etching, Robin wipes the plate clean. Only the filigree of lines bitten by the acid remains drenched in ink and will come out black in the finished work.
Oddly enough, I've always liked black and white, so that I can't ever have had the feeling that so amuses us that many people have when they're shown Robin's work. And they say, yes, very nice. Of course, I like a bit of colour myself. I have learnt through watching Robin and through helping him print how many shades of what he calls colour, and which is really tone, you can get into a drawing.
I'm always terrified at this stage, aren't you? Just wondering what'll happen.
Robin approaches the climactic moment with all the anxiety of a great chef praying that his souffle has risen.
Oh, it's going to be rather easily. I hope I have it sufficiently down. No, I think it's all right. That's through. What's it like?
Lovely.
Well, it is better, isn't it?
I love the faithfulness, the loving presentation of what a plant or a flower or a building or whatever he happens to be drawing actually is. He's got its character and shown that each part of it's been seen and understood and loved.
This rare departure from black and white celebrates Robin's feelings for heather, its main subject, and for the flowers of spring. The passion for unspoilt nature, which unites Robin and Heather Tanner, has a long history. It dates from the days when they first met at school more than 70 years ago.
Our greatest good fortune was to find ourselves in the same form as children. And as sixth formers, we fell in love. And we've been in love ever since.
And it'll come. And it's, you know, just two things.
There's Lord
Altamilla
and the Grove Garden.
We should have liked to have bought and found a good old Cotswold house. But as that was not possible, my uncle offered to design it, a house for us, as a wedding gift. He had hoped that if people liked the house we lived in, others might give him an order for houses. He designed the house with Voysey tradition in mind, and it does resemble very much some of the houses in the Voysey catalogue. And we were very lucky because we had not only an architect uncle, but various craftsmen or workmen in the family who helped to eke out the furniture which my uncle had cleverly designed as part of the house. He designed the bookshelves, the dresser and the wardrobes in as part of the fittings so that we hadn't got to buy those things. Then Robin's brother, who was a worker in wood, made us that bookcase there. And Robin's father made us various shelves and things, including the dressers.
We started out with the idea, didn't we, that we would have nothing that was manufactured,
yes,
save by our friends and us. And on the whole, I think we've kept to that.
We had to. The house was left just as it had been built, so that we had to start doing things for ourselves straight away.
That's how we
and
spent
have done
our
ever since, haven't we?
That was our honeymoon, do you remember?
It was.
You got housemaid's knee, I remember. For scrubbing.
All the tanner's furniture will eventually go to the craft study centre they helped to found in Bath. Some has gone already. Their pleasures cost them so little that they also give all the profits they make from creative work to their favourite causes. In the world beyond their woodland garden and beyond their little patch of Wiltshire, the tanners are dedicated Quakers and pacifists. But they've never been dreamers, sheltering from the pressures of a real working life. Robin spent many years as a schools inspector, and Heather was a teacher. In 1939, they offered to share their Wiltshire haven with a victim of Nazi persecution, whom they'd never met, but who's lived with them ever since. Dietrich Hanf was a boy of 18, who escaped by one day the concentration camps in which his family died.
He became part of the family as the second we set eyes on him. Having it... It was almost like giving birth after all the struggle to get him.
Dietrich himself has now retired from lecturing in education. After 43 years, he shares the pleasures and pursues the causes of his adoptive parents.
Heather, who are you writing to now, then?
Me? Oh, my MP, as usual.
As usual. Look, Heather, I've got 5 apples here. Is that all right? It's not too many.
No, that would give us 1 2/3 of an apple each.
Excuse fingers.
Robin and Heather took me in as their son. It became a real family relationship. I think they're just lovely people to get on with. Always busy, full of energy. That's marvellous.
It must be 55 years, Heather, since I did this, my first etching, Allington in Wiltshire. Oh, I was in my first teaching job in Deptford. I was very homesick, and I put into it all my longing for home. And I remember Stanley Anderson saying, "You've never seen an elm tree like that." And I thought, "No, Stanley Anderson, aren't you unlucky? I have." Well, of course, this, do you remember? This is the first we printed here, the year we were married, 1931, on our press here.
Huge plate.
Oh, it was huge and difficult to do because it's so large.
I remember that rick being thatched.
Yes, that was old Mr. Besant, wasn't it? Oh, it was a feat. I don't think I could attempt anything like it now, you know. Not that scale, anyhow. Ah, this, of course, I've a special feeling for June. This was after a long gap. The war had ended, and I wanted to celebrate a return to what I hoped would be better even than normality. And so I had everything perfect. Perfect weather. And look at these perfect dog roses, almost double the size they should be.
Well, June is your favourite, but this one, Gray's Elegy, is mine. For one thing, it is technically the best one you've ever done. So it would be my favourite for that reason, but there are many other reasons. Those tombstones were done locally, so it has the local feeling for me. Also, I share your love of graves and of snowdrops and primroses and so on growing on them. But it's also my favouriteness is to do with this vista, which reminds me of all the 18th century engravings and early 19th century engravings. It has in itself a feeling of nostalgia. It looks as though it's a closing down to a quiet end there, which is why I so love it.
Of course, I chose deliberately to make it really from that particular verse. Mm. Beneath those rugged elms, that yew tree's shade, where heaves the turf in many a mouldering heap, each in his narrow cell, forever laid the rude forefathers of the hamlet sleep. That's what I've wanted to catch, that kind of feeling, which I feel is so much grey. Of course, I'm often accused of being an idealist. Actually, I'm very proud to be one. I always feel that the ideal world that I etch and paint could be ours if we had the sense to work for it and do less destruction. That's the thing I slave for. That's where my patriotism runs. I'm really very British, but the Britain I love is that Britain.
In all the years Robin was a schools inspector, he had no time to do a single etching. But he never stopped drawing, and 40 years ago, he and Heather started to plan a book on wild plants, which she would write and he would illustrate. Slowly, the enormity of the task made them confine it to woodland plants only, and then to just a selection of those. But the work has never stopped.
Double ones never interest me so much. It's these lovely singles I like.
With the sheathed colour.
Yes, and a single drop.
The wild flowers of their native county are not the tanner's only subject. Heather's book, Wiltshire Village, is a classic description of rural life, illustrated by Robin. But in their 79th year, the creative spark shines brightest where it always has.
We loved all wild plants, and we both drew them. But woodland plants had a very special attraction for us. You know, lots of them are rather witchy and strange. Many of them are green or white. And Heather was interested in their histories and so on. And from 1940 onwards, I drew wild flower after wild flower as they bloomed in our own garden and in the woodlands around. I made hundreds, I think I could truthfully say thousands, of studies of these. And then it was that we saw that a book would emerge from it.
There are two wild hellebores, the stinking, which droops its spells downwards, and the green hellebore, which is rarer, which opens its flowers like this so that you can fully see them and see this pretty goldeny pale gold centre so conspicuous against the green behind. And what is so fascinating about it is that it will go on and on looking as though it's in bloom for months, because these are technically not the petals which would go as soon as it was fertilised. They are the sepals, and on they stay, looking exactly as though the flower is still in bloom. The first sign of spring in that sudden warmth that comes fills me with a feeling of tremendous elation. It's a sort of golden age feeling. And the worse the winter's been, of course, the more is that feeling an exciting one. But of course, it doesn't come just like that. That's one day. And then will come a sudden winter again. And so it goes to and fro until it's really established. And when it's thoroughly established, it seems to say, quick, let's get over everything all at once. And suddenly, before you know where it is, it's summer and you feel you've missed it all.
A flower whose pungent smell makes it difficult to miss is wild garlic.
Heather, what amazes me is that each of those flowers is a perfect six-petaled one, and then you've always some to come later. You have buds and fully open flowers. That's what makes it in this marvellous globe, this...
It makes it a hemisphere.
A hemisphere, yes. And it's not a solid hemisphere, is it? It's crenellated, it's lacy. That's what gives it its marvellous quality. I think it's an incredible plant. If it costs guineas per bulb, you know, we should treasure it instead of despising it. When I joined the inspectorate in the mid-30s, a job I loved, inspecting is not a description of it, really. I did find it quite impossible to pursue my beloved craft of etching, but every day of my life I drew. So I could take up my drawings of woodland plants as you might take up knitting and just do a scrap, do you see?
I wait till he's done the drawing before I do the writing, because I call attention in the text to something that's fascinated him and made him draw it, obviously. But he's highly critical of my writing and I of his drawing.
In a way, it's a miracle that we've lived in such comparative harmony. But I think a great thing has been that we've both travelled in the same direction, do you see? This love of the natural world has always been basic to us. And it has always seemed right that I should draw and paint and etch, and that she should put down in writing her feeling. But the feeling is common to us both, so that it's very difficult over a book like Woodland Plants to say who did this and who did that. Yes, I actually did all the drawings, Heather did all the writing, but I think the work was conceived in a twin sort of way.
Yes, it's nice and mixed.
Yes, with the bluebells, the dog's Mercury. What else have we got at our feet?
There was Goldilocks a little way back.
Goldilocks. Mm. Did you find a perfect flower?
One.
I'm sure you didn't.
Just one
perfect flower.
And, of course, goosegrass climbing over everything.
And doesn't it make you feel that old Hardy would love to be here? Can you remember it? When the present has latched its postern behind my tremulous stay, and the May month flaps its glad green leaves like wings, delicate filmed as new-spun silk, will the neighbours say he was a man who used to notice such things?
Few people in this headlong world live to see a 40-year joint effort come to fulfilment. But with the arrival of the first copy of Woodland Plants, the tanners can at last enjoy the fruits of a life's work.
Let's see what the reproduction is like.
I like the top, the heading, and the end cover.
Oh, that's good. Very good. Very truthful.
I think anyone who's been able to do, mostly throughout their life, what they like doing, is extremely lucky. And at the same time, that sentence fills me with horror, because if the world were the right place, every person would be doing what they were most fitted for and enjoying it. That they are not doing so shows that there's something very wrong with the world.
And sadly, Robin Tanner died in 1988.